there's this first question about video games. So since video games are the go-to of children right now, and they can be really good at it, can this be defined as a hobby, or is it already an addiction? What do you think about that?
It depends. Well, I'm going to say there are some extraordinary good video games that actually are creative. If I was to say, all of you, the single greatest source of how you can figure out is it a healthy a video game or not, parents, please go to Common Sense, S-E-N-S-E Media. It's free. It is a website that is a goldmine, because anytime your kid wants to play a video game or watch a movie or put an app on their phone, Common Sense Media Free will tell you, is it appropriate, is it not, based on a score of different researchers who are looking at it. So the first thing is, the problem with that question is that it depends upon the game. And there are certain cases that I've seen some extraordinary games that actually are helpful to kids in terms of creativity, particularly when they play with another kid. Now, that said, what we do know also is, I want you to watch your child a little closer, parents in particular, because you're the ones that are seeing them on the game. Because what happens a lot of times is that it actually isn't healthy, because you'll see a change in the child's behavior, that instead of being relaxed, you'll be more worked up. Instead of being, whoa, he'll be actually more aggressive. That is a real red flag that said, so why is he playing the game? We also know that a lot of the video games are robbing our kids of sleep. And that's one of the biggest reasons why they're now more depressed and more stressed and don't have that self-control. So you've got to be the parent to ask yourself first, is it a healthy hobby? I would certainly say find some other ones. Because otherwise, what's going to happen is the rest of his life is going to be plugged in. And what will happen, he'll be plugged out of other things. And that could be a real tragedy.
In this topic on the ability of the teaching profession, and for the sake of those who are first time probably to attend our seminars, let me give a brief introduction about myself. Okay, well, my name is Emmanuel Rentoy. I've been a teacher for the last 34 years. I have not left the classroom except last year when I was based in Sri Lanka. And then I came back, and so now I'm back here for good. And I was teaching in the University of Asia in the Pacific until my departure for Sri Lanka. And I continue being connected with UANP, a university there in Pasig City. Also, I was connected in an all-boys school, Paref Northfield School, in Quezon City, now in Sun Valley, Antipolo. I founded a school in Iloilo City called Paref Westbridge School. It's an all-boys school, which is now one of the top schools in Region 6. And I am a graduate of Southridge, where I also served for 15 years as principal of intermediate school, vice principal of high school, and department head of religion. But the last 11 years, I've spent more time going around the Philippines and around the world, reaching out to teachers like you and parents and community leaders, trying to champion character formation, because that's what I saw as the crisis, where the crisis is. And we're going to see more of that today. And I'm also the executive director now of the Center for the Fourth and Fifth Hours Asia. In fact, the certificate you're going to receive for attendance to our seminars this next 10 days, today up to July 22, are issued. The certificates are issued by the Center for the Fourth and Fifth Hours, based in the State University of New York with Dr. Thomas Licona as the president and a signatory. That's why this is considered an international seminar that you are participating in, otherwise known as the Dr. Thomas Licona Institute for Asia. Center for Fourth and Fifth Hours, because our principle is every human being, aside from knowing reading, writing, arithmetic, should have respect and responsibility. Respect and responsibility. So all those two virtues are going to come out again and again these next 10 days, especially when we talk of strategies for online teaching, strategies to give character formation online. Respect and responsibility will have to come out again and again. Okay, well, today we're going to talk about the nobility of the teaching profession. Of course, we know how noble it is, but it's good to start, or to at least to prepare the start of a new school year, keeping this in mind, reminding ourselves of the importance of our job as teachers, the nobility of our profession, so that we are ready to commit ourselves again and really commit our heart and mind to becoming the best teachers we can possibly be because of the nobility of our profession. A teacher is never an ordinary person, according to Chanakya. Construction and destruction can be produced in his lap. And that's true, right? Some of us maybe decided to become teachers thanks to some inspiring teachers that we've had. Some teachers who really made a difference in our life, and we are so grateful to them. And we can say we are who we are today because of them. But here's the sad reality. I have met some people who are full of resentments towards authority, towards adults, because they had some teachers who terrorized them, who scarred them, and maybe because of the kind of treatment they received, they have formulated a concept of teachers being like that. Well, you and I know, especially those of you who have been like me for decades, have been inside the classroom, we know that if a teacher lasts more than 3 years in the profession, chances are that teacher knows how to sacrifice. I mean, it is there, he is there, she is there because of a great sacrifice. Especially in the Philippines, no? Because we know that in the Philippines, teachers are not paid according to how much really we deserve. I mean, really, even if DepEd will increase payment of public school teachers, we know we deserve more because the work that we put in is priceless. The work that we put in is priceless. You cannot put a price tag on it. And then I know many of you who work hard even after the bell rings, checking papers up to midnight sometimes to be able to submit grades on time. Many of you who work even on Saturday and Sunday, finishing that unit plan, that lesson plan, so that we are able to submit it on time. Or some of you who, as soon as you wake up in the morning, iniisip nyo kagad, ano, yung discipline problem that you are working on, investigating. Iniisip nyo kagad yung students who whom you need to sit down with because they are failing in three subjects or more. So we know that. We have gone through things like that. Japanese proverb tells us, you know, the real king of the world are the young generation. Because they are going to be tomorrow's leaders. And that's true. When I get invited to speak to students, I spend more time talking to teachers and parents and community leaders. But every so often, I get invited to give talks to students. Last week, I just spent whole morning or whole afternoon with 200 student leaders of Holy Angel University. And every time I'm talking to students, I tell them, after talking about the crisis in character, the problem in the world today, the complaints many of us have about the millennials, about the, how they call that, the self-entitled generation, etc. I end by saying, but you know, you young guys are not the problem. You're the solution to our problem. Really, the young people are our solution. They are the ones who are going to fix Philippine society, for example, because they are the ones who are going to sit there in Congress, in Senate, in Malacanang. They are the ones that we are preparing to eventually take over. And how Philippine society will be at that point depends now inside our classroom. That's how important our job is. That's how noble our profession is, because we are preparing the future of the country. We are preparing the future of Malacanang, Senate, Congress. You know, 75% of students, according to a study, said that they looked up to teachers as mentors and role models. Teachers, that's the, they're the ones that they really see as the ones who are in a position to guide them. And 79% of students said that their teachers encouraged them to follow their dreams. You see how important our job is. We are the ones responsible, therefore. I mean, 75%, 79%, that's a good, more than just a great majority. Okay, of course, we know that the parents are supposed to be the primary educators of the children. The parents are the ones who are supposed to be forming their character. But we cannot also deny the fact that the students spend a lot of time inside our classroom, inside our Zoom room or Google Meet room or Microsoft Team room. So, for all of you who have been in the teaching profession for years and you have made the difference in the lives of hundreds of people that have passed through your grade 2 classroom, grade 5 classroom, thank you. Thank you for your hard work. Thank you because of all the sacrifices that you've been putting to be able to prepare the young people to take over leadership. Ang problema kasi dito is, you know, pagka ang isang lamesa sira, pag isang silya sira, madaling sabihin, sino bang gumawa niyan? Ibalik nga yan sa karpintero para ipaayos, no? If something is defective, we can easily say, ibalik sa workshop, sa carpentry work. Sa now, if a person grows up to be immoral, corrupt, bad, it's not possible to say, sino bang teacher niyan sa grade 5 values? Ibalik nga yan, ibalik. Rejected yan, hindi pasado. We only have one shot. This is it. The 10 months the student spends with us. The 1 year that we handle them in that subject. That's it. That's what we have. That's the time we have to be able to make the difference, form the character, mold the minds of the young people that have been entrusted to our care. And so, the many who have grown up to be moral, good, brilliant, hardworking, but especially not just smart, but especially good. Thank you, teachers, for all the hard work that you put in. You know, this brings to mind my favorite teacher. My favorite teacher is this man who was a teacher in San Beda College for 38 years and 22 years in Southridge. 38 years in San Beda, Mendiola, and 22 in Southridge. 60 years as an academician. That's my favorite teacher, my father, who brought up 10 of us, 10 children. I'm number 10 in a family of 10. And when he passed away, when was that? 3 years ago, he left behind 25 grandchildren and 17 great-grandchildren. That's why I always tell teachers when he was still alive, you see what happens when you teach? You live long. You live very long. And that's what it is, really. When we devote ourselves to teaching, taking care of people, taking care of the young people, we don't die in the hearts of our students. We live forever. And for that, we thank you, dear teachers. And in spite of the pandemic, we continue teaching. That's why I'd like to share this video with all of you as a way of saying thank you for last year's difficult year. I mean, let's not deny it, okay? Last year was terrible, was horrible, was we were forced into this situation where we suddenly have to teach online, which we are not trained for. I mean, really, let's face it. Let's accept it. Let's admit it. This is not what we studied in the School of Education. This is not what we've been trained to do. But we didn't give up. You continue teaching and you're still here. Ever since we continued teaching, in spite of the lockdown, in spite of the quarantine, in spite of the threats of COVID everywhere. That's why Colin Wilcox says, teaching is the greatest act of optimism. I mean, really, the fact that we continued teaching is telling the world, let's move on. I mean, let's not allow the pandemic, the quarantine, the lockdown to stop us from moving forward, especially in learning, especially in the young people, in training the young people, forming them to be good, to be smart, and to be successful. Teaching is the greatest act of optimism, aside from being such a noble profession. Those of you who have been teaching high school, especially, congratulations. I know how even more difficult. Sabi nila, ang hirap turuan yung mga bata sa online. But you know, ang maganda sa pagturo sa mga bata, yung mga talagang bata, is chances are the parents are there supervising and looking over. Pero yung mga high schoolers, I mean, you don't expect the parents to be watching over. Kasi ang expectation natin is mas expert pa nga yung mga high schoolers na yan, ano? Grade 7 rather, all the way to 12. Ina-expect pa nga natin na mas magaling pa sila sa technology. But that's precisely it. That makes it even harder. Lalo na't napaka-expert na mga yan. Ano? Ang akala mo nakatingin sa screen, pero nagte-text pala with one hand. Or ang akala mo nakatingin sa screen, yung pala nakabukas din yung Netflix at saka Facebook at saka Twitter at saka TikTok at saka Instagram. So, the challenge is real. The struggle is real as well for you teachers. But let's not forget, it's also a struggle for a number of students, for many students. They too are grappling, are having a tough time. And so let's move on, let's forge ahead, let's be forgiving with ourselves as we are also forgiving with the students. After all, the nobility of our profession calls us not just to do a job, but to fulfill a mission. From character.org. This is a very important point to keep in mind. We did not choose a job, we chose a mission. This is more than just an employment. We will look more into that. Mission versus employment. You know, mission means you have been sent, right? That's from the Latin word mito, mitere, misi, missus. Therefore, missus means sent. You are a man sent, a woman sent to take care of the young people. More than just an employment. But here's the reality of it. Here's something that is real in the Philippines. We have many teachers who enter the profession because they need an employment, because they need to earn. because they need a salary, because they need to bring home food and bring food to the table. Now, there is nothing wrong with that. I mean, there's nothing wrong with wanting to have a job and wanting to have an employment and wanting to have a salary. Of course, we need salary. Of course, we need employment. Of course, we need to survive. But here's the message now of this slide. You are there in such an important job, so noble, so crucial, that we might as well do it with a sense of mission. We might as well do the best that we can, because failure in this job, failure in this employment, has great consequences. It's not just about a chair not working, a table that is defective. It's about seeing young people growing up not according to how they should, or not according to their purpose, or not according to even supernaturally the will of God. That's why effectively, really, we are men and women on a mission. Teachers are men and women on a mission. It's more than just a job, but it is. And therefore, sometimes I tell teachers, okay, minsan nagre-reklamo tayo, ano? Kulang ang sweldo, maliit ang sweldo. Especially here in the Philippines, we are underpaid, really. I mean, compared to how other countries are paying teachers. I heard in the United States, for example, a fresh graduate, fresh out of college, and then gets accepted in the teaching profession, can be receiving $3,500 a month. Wow, that's around 175,000 pesos, which is four times, five times, sometimes even six times, or maybe even 10 times what a teacher here in the Philippines can be receiving. But, you know, even if sometimes we complain about the salary, we convince ourselves that, hey, but I have a job. I mean, I'm being paid to do this job. And so I also would have to, out of fairness to my employer, out of fairness to the school, the institution that is paying for me, I also should leave the school at the end of the day convinced that I have worked according to what I have been paid. I mean, that I am not also shortchanging the school, the institution that is also paying for my work. But more than just a job, we have a mission here. We have this, I'm sure many of you have read this or have heard this. If you're doing it only because you are paid for it, it's a job. But if you're doing it not only for the pay, but also for the service, it's a mission. Especially the service that we are preparing tomorrow's future, tomorrow's leaders, tomorrow's president of the Philippines, senators of the Philippines, congressmen in the Philippines, politicians and presidents of companies, people who are going to create the kind of world we will have in the future. That's a great service to society. If you quit because your boss or colleague criticized you, it's a job. If you keep on teaching out of love, it's a mission. And I also, as principal and vice principal for many years, as administrator for more than half my professional life, I always tell teachers that if your supervisor, if your principal, if your subject coordinator on top of you is correcting you, that's a very good sign. Ibig sabihin, ang tingin nila sa'yo, may pag-asa pa to eh. Kaya pa tong tulungan. This guy can still improve. And that's why if they correct us, that's a very good sign of trust. Because I've experienced this as an administrator where some officers will say, never mind, patapusin na lang natin yung school year. Hindi natin i-renew kontrata niyan. I mean, I've seen that happen in my 34 years inside the classroom And I think of the 34 years, I would say 25 years of them as administrator, I've heard co-officers saying things like that. Hindi ba, Lina? Pabayaan mo na lang yan. Patapusin na lang natin yung school year. Tapos hindi natin i-re-renew yung kontrata niya. You see, if the officers stop correcting us, it may mean because they have given up on us. But if they continue correcting us about our punctuality, about our on-time submission or non-submission of unit plans, grades, reports, no? If they continue correcting us, it means they continue expecting us to be better. They continue trusting and believing that we can do better and that we can do more. And maybe that's their way of preparing us for, I don't know, being officers in the future. That's their way of preparing us to be eventually in charge of a unit, of a subject, of a level, of a school. So, if you quit because your boss or colleague criticize you, that's merely a job. But if you keep on teaching out of love, it's a mission. If you teach because it does not interfere with your other activities, it's a job. If you are committed to teaching, even if it means letting go of other activities, it's a mission. And at this point, it's good to ask ourselves, those of you who have been teaching for 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, have you been fulfilling a job or fulfilling a mission? Especially so since, I mean, the nobility of the teaching profession is precisely because we impact the students. We influence them. Minsan, ang lakas ng impluensya ng teacher, the students copy even the wrong grammar of the teacher. I mean, I've seen that. Sometimes they even copy the way we talk, the way we walk, the way we express ourselves. I mean, really, we affect the students. We cannot tell. No one can tell where our influence stops. And then we went through what we call a learning curve. Nahirapan tayo talaga lahat. Lahat sa umpisa. And then as we went on, as we continued on, we got better. And we learned better ways of doing things. We learned to be more forgiving and understanding. We learned, for example, that, ay oo nga, totoong may problema ang SMART and GLOBE in many places, many times. And so we were more ready to hear excuses from students like, sir, naputo lang wifi namin. Sir, na-disconnect ako. Sir, data lang ang gamit ko, kaya I cannot turn on my video. And then we realized, ay oo nga, kasi tayo mismo, we also experience getting disconnected, suddenly getting logged out, suddenly wifi not working. I mean, and then as we continued on, we just felt so relieved that we have finished a school year. And now we're preparing for another one more year like that, probably. Hopefully, not more. Hopefully, somewhere along the way, we will be ready to get back inside the classroom. If not 100%, okay, blended, mixed, hybrid. Some students attending inside the classroom, some others following online. But we pray and we look forward to that day that we will get back. Nevertheless, you who continue teaching, you continue giving the young people hope. This is another source of the nobility of the teaching profession. That even without saying a word, just by the fact that you show up there in the Zoom room, there in the Google Meet room, there in the Microsoft Teams office, there in your LMS, your learning management system, the fact that you continued showing up, the fact that you continued communicating with the students, that sent a message of optimism. That sent a message to the young people that, hey, let's continue on, let's move on. Life is tough and we will encounter things like this, but it's not reason to quit and to give up. And this thing, by the way, this year that just passed, the year that you taught online is going to leave a mark in the minds of the young people. 20 years from now, maybe this is what they will remember more than what the other things that happened inside the classroom. This may be what will leave a mark in them that will tell them, I have to forge ahead. I cannot quit. I cannot give up. You see, this is at the root of the nobility of the teaching profession, that we are teaching even with our example, especially with our example. That's why children are like wet cement. Whatever falls on them makes an impression. We left an impression in the minds of the students of what it means not to quit, not to give up, and to move on in spite of the difficulties, in spite of the pandemic, the lockdown, the quarantine. Students don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. That's why hindi ako fan ng mga teachers na nagyayabang na valedictorian sila, summa cum laude graduate, ganyan, ano? Students really don't care much about that until they know how much you care. In fact, I've seen teachers in my 34 years working in so many different schools, being consultant to many different schools around the Philippines. I've seen teachers na napakagaling nga, summa cum laude nga, valedictorian nga, but they didn't survive, especially because of a certain, I'm not saying all of them are like that, but I've met some of them who, capitalizing on their being valedictorian and summa cum laude, taught with arrogance, taught with that kind of, that air of, makinig kayo sa akin, matalino ko, makinig kayo sa akin, valedictorian ako, makinig kayo sa akin, summa cum laude ako. I've seen teachers who, because of that kind of attitude, didn't even last a quarter. I mean, I remember one teacher, for example, one month, that's all it took. Because ang akala niya, porket summa cum laude siya, pagpasok niya ng classroom, students will be worshiping him. The students couldn't care less about your degrees, your honors, your prestige, until they know how much you care. They're not really looking for the summas. If you are like that, fantastic. You're brilliant. You're a genius. But students need more than just credentials. They need caring. That's why if you were with us in the class advisory seminar that we had last week or last June, I mentioned the three things on top of the mind of every student on day one. Three things on top of the mind of every student on day one. Am I in the right classroom? Can I sit anywhere? And then the third very important one, who are you as a teacher? They want to know, anong klaseng teacher ka? Are you going to be like those favorite of mine who took care of me, who were very understanding, who motivated me, who pushed me when I needed it? Or are you going to be like those who terrorized me, who hurt me, who even scarred me? Who are you as a teacher? That's the third thing on top of the mind of every student. They want to know, anong klaseng teacher tayo? And really, it's not about valedictorian ka ba? Summa cum laude ka ba? Matalino ka ba? IQ mo ba is 150 and higher? No, they are more concerned about how will you treat us students? Will you care for us? And that's what they care more about how we will care for them. The test of a good teacher is not how many questions he can ask his pupils that they will answer readily, but how many questions he inspires them to ask him, which he finds it hard to answer. Inspire. And that word is going to come out again and again if we are going to talk about the ideal teacher. Inspiring, motivating, pare-pareho silang meaning, ano? Sparking excitement over learning. That is a good teacher. And those of you who know, alam nyo yan eh, because students like you, students go to you and bring up things with you that have nothing to do with subject matter, with the subject you're teaching. They just want to talk to you because you have inspired them beyond the subject. We have move them beyond merely the academic that we are teaching them, that we are handling with them. Teaching kids to count is fine, but teaching them what counts is best. And this is why our principal in CEP, Character Education Partnership, in the Center for the Fourth and Fifth R's, is that one, character formation. Because that is really what counts. I mean, what do we care about students becoming experts in math, experts in science, pero gagamitin nila ang kanilang katalinuhan to steal from government money, from taxpayers' money, to take advantage of people, to abuse and things like that, no? I mean, what does it matter if napakagalingan ng English mo, pero wala kang pagmamahal sa sariling wika, wala kang pagmamahal sa sarili nating bayan? I mean, patriotism is, I think, higher than expression skills, no? There are things that count really more than simply being able to do addition, subtraction, subtraction and multiplication. So, the nobility of the teaching profession lies also in the fact that this is it. Kahit anong subject ang ituro natin, we are capable of forming character, molding minds. Such is the nobility of our profession na kahit science ang tinuturo mo, you can actually teach the students grit, resilience, empathy. From your example, you can teach them professionalism. From the way you treat the students, you can teach them kindness, respect, courtesy. And yet, ang subject mo is science. Ang subject mo is social studies. Ang subject mo is English. But over and above these things, through our example, we can teach them virtues, values, professionalism, hard work, industriousness. And then, even better, we have a lot of airtime. Airtime na kahit na math ang tinuturo natin, every so often, we can actually comment about the headlines of the day. Such is the nobility of our profession. At any time, we can choose to suddenly shift our discussion to character, values, virtues, the most noble things in life, faith, religion, love for God. I mean, such is the power of the teacher. We are given so much time, air time, that we can directly or indirectly teach the students or give instruction. That is the nobility of our profession. Dear teacher, I am a survivor of a concentration camp. My eyes saw what no man should witness: gas chambers built by learned engineers, children poisoned by educated physicians, infants killed by trained nurses, women and babies shot and burned by high school and college students. This is a letter written by a Holocaust survivor. So, I am suspicious of education. My request is, dear teachers, help your students become human. Your efforts must never produce learned monsters, skilled psychopaths, and Eichmanns, one of the engineers of the Holocaust. Reading, writing, arithmetic are important only if they serve to make our children more human. It's a very powerful letter written by a Holocaust survivor telling us, teachers, let's teach the students what matters most, what counts, what really counts in life: humanity. I'm sure you have all come across this quotation: the mediocre teacher tells, the good teacher explains, the superior teacher demonstrates, but the great teacher. And that's what we all want to be. That's why you're here in this presentation on the nobility of our profession. We want to be great teachers, not mediocre, not even just good, not even just superior, but really great ones who inspire, who make a difference, who motivate, who prepare these future leaders. And we think especially of those who need us most. I mean, diba inside the classroom, iba-iba ang mga estudyante. We have some who are so motivated, kahit na hindi mo bantayan, gagawin at gagawin niya yung ipapagawa mo sa kanya. And will do his best to produce an output that is exceptional. But there are those na kailangan bantayan. Kailangan i-check mo. Kailangan to call his attention. Kailangan i-remind so often. Well, those are the ones who need us more. They are the ones that because of them, we can say, wow, my job, my being a teacher is a vocation. It's more than just a job. It's a mission. I am on a mission to enrich the lives of my students, to enhance the quality of the lives of my students, especially those whose lives need a lot of improvement or a lot of working. It's a vocation. So teaching is more than just a job and employment. It is a mission, but it's also a vocation. And if you have lasted for many years, I saw Dr. Hidalgo there, I saw Mr. Inglaterra, these are teachers who have been there for decades. And you can say, wow, these people have the vocation. If you have lasted so long in the teaching profession, in spite of the challenges, I would even dare to say, in spite of the pay, it's because you are fulfilling a vocation. What is a vocation? It comes from the Latin word voco, vocare, vocatus, to call. And vocation, vocatus, is called. We are called. But you know, when you are called, someone is calling. And you know who are calling? Who is calling you? I mean, why do we say that our profession is noble? It's a mission. And then it's a vocation. It's a calling. But somebody is calling. Who? Okay, society is calling. Children are calling. The parents are calling. We look at the world today. I mean, I'm not siding with any political factions right now. But we know for a fact that there are many things that need to be worked on. Corruption continues to be a problem systemically, and it's been there for decades. Society is in dire need of heroes, of people who are going to step up and will say once and for all, we have to stop corruption, and we have to especially have the poor, the poorest of the poor in the first place, as our priority, taking care of them. Society is calling teachers. Teachers, come on. Send us those men and women of character who are going to bring about change. I mean, real change in our society for the better. And then the young people, the children, who are being victimized by the environment. We talked about it in one of the talks, the urgency of character formation in the June series. The children are under attack, under assault by technological addiction, by social media deformation. Yeah. Their values are being attacked by social media. The children are the victims. I was telling teachers in the June series, ma'am, sir, pag may pumasok sa classroom mo na bata, acting like, anong tawag natin doon dati? Spoiled brat. Di ba ganun yung description natin? Parang ngayon, politically incorrect to use the term spoiled brat. But you know what I'm talking about. Pag may pumasok sa classroom mo, isang spoiled kid, spoiled brat, yung bang bigyan mo lang ng assignment, puro reklamo na siya. Sasabihan mo lang, please read chapter, reklamo na kagad siya. Na parang tinotorture, ano? Parang pinaparusahan. Tapos pagka pagsabihan mo about respect and courtesy, aba, siya pa ang galit. Now, if you have a student like that, please don't give up on a student like that. The reason why he or she is coming inside your classroom is precisely not for math, not for science, not for English. She or he needs to learn character from you. Maybe because she's not learning it at home. Maybe because we've seen it also happen, right? You sometimes have students who come inside your classroom. They don't know respect. They don't know kindness. They don't know courtesy. They don't know the basic things of dealings, relations with people. That kid comes inside your classroom with an unlit candle telling you, "Ma'am, sir, please light my candle. I don't want to be in the dark anymore." But his way or her way of saying it is, pasaway, mahirap pagsabihan, you have to repeat again and again, stop talking, listen, sit up straight, eyes here on the board, listen, don't be distracted. And we have to repeat it 25 times every 5 minutes. I mean, I'm not exaggerating. You've had students who are like that. But we are in the profession because of children like that. They're the ones calling us. And then the parents. We talked about this also before. There are 11 million Filipinos working abroad, OFWs. And many of them left behind children of school age. May kilala kong estudyante ang nagpapalaki yung kapitbahay, ano? Because both parents preferred to be able to send dollars back home. Well, the parents need us. They need our help. They need us to fill in the gap, to fill in the vacuum that they have left for them to be able to work abroad. Sure, merong FaceTime, may Viber, may FB Messenger video, audio call, but it's just not the same. It is just not the same. You and I know this. And many times, yung problematic students we have inside our classroom, madidiscover natin, ay kaya naman pala, wala ang nanay, wala ang tatay, walang parent supervision. Lalo na't ngayon, online ang classes. What we used to do inside the classroom in disciplining, we expect the parents now to be the ones doing it at home. But if the parents are not there, they're calling us. They're asking for our help. So, who's calling? Why is this a vocation? Society is calling. The children are calling. The parents are pleading, begging for your help. And God is telling you, telling us, ikaw na bahala, raise them up to be good people, to be men and women of faith, in spite of the message they're receiving from social media, TV, Netflix, music, MTV, billboards, commercialism. I mean, in spite of what the world is, that's why I said the children are under attack. And even faith is under attack. I mean, if you've been in Facebook long enough, Twitter long enough, you would know how there is an effort to kick out God from public life, to kick out God from the life of people. They are the ones calling us. That's why it's a vocation. Society calls, children are calling, parents are calling, God is calling on us, teachers. It's a vocation. So then, such is the nobility of your job as teachers. That's what we just mentioned earlier. Education is not the filling of a pail, but the lighting of a fire. I mean, I know I've said this story in one talk recently, but let me share the story with you. Diba minsan may ganyan kang estudyante, no? Na pagpasok mo ng eskwelahan, you look around and then you realize, uy, absent si Jan. Absent si Jan. Thank you, God. It's gonna be a great day today. we feel bad thinking that way. But really, it happens. Na minsan, because alam mo itong estudyante na itong pasaway, every time makita mo pa lang, parang iniisip mo, ano na naman kayang iniisip niyang kasamaan? Ano na naman kayang iniisip niyang kabalastugan? Ayan, no? I mean, we've had students like that, right? Who challenge our patience, who challenge our self-control. objective of the day, not to shout, scream, and yell at John or at Joey or at that student that gets into our nerves. I had a student like that in the all-boys school. Yung bang pagpasok mo na, pagka ito yung klaseng student, third year high school when I handled him, pag sinabihan mong, Jay, sit down. Diba dati, pag sinabihan mong gano'n ng bata, abay uupo lang siya ng tahimik. Pero ito, yung tipong, pag sinabihan mong, Jay, sit down. Ang sama ng tingin sa'yo. Ang sama ng tingin sa'yo. Parang ikaw pang may kasalanan. Parang gusto mong sabihin yung sinabi ni Bea Alonso. Bakit? Ba't parang kasalanan ko? Ba't ako? Parang ako may kasalanan pa. Ikaw na nga itong nagdidisiplina sa kanya. So, you tell him, Jay, sit down. Sama ng tingin sa'yo. Minsan may mumbling pa. Dami-dami ditong nakatayo. Ako lang papaupuin. Lagi akong pinag-iinitan. Yung ganyan, ano? Yung parang gusto mong sabihin, patayin kita niyan eh. Pero hindi mo pwede sabihin yung ganyan. Masama yon. Okay. Pero napansin ko, itong si Jay, aba, pinapakinggan ng kanyang mga ka-classmates. Pagka ako, halimbawa, pag nagsabi ako sa class, class, please bring newspaper for the school paper drive, ha? Para naman may, ano, may contribution ng class natin. Walang magdadala. Pero pag si Jay nagsalita sa harap ng class, hey guys, newspapers tomorrow, ha? Bugbugin ko kayo pag wala kayo. Lahat nagdadala. Lahat ng classmates ko magdadala. Nananalo kami. Laging pinakamaraming school newspapers sa school paper drive, yung newspaper drive. So one day, I decided to do something strange. I thought, may, kasi nakikinig yung mga classmates niya sa kanya. So I called him, JJ, come here. You know, I've decided I'm going to put up a club. I'm going to put up a club and I'm going to make you the president. We're going to call it the Organization for Student Empowerment. Tapos ikaw ang gagawin kong president ng club. Tapos ganito gawin natin. Pili ka ng 5 of your best friends in the class. Third year. Tapos all boys. Pili ka ng 5 of your best friends. Yung kaya mong, ano, yung you like working with. Okay? Sila ang magiging ibang officers of the club. Tapos, ganitong gawin natin. Di ba may bahay kayo sa Tagaytay? Sabihin mo naman sa tatay mo, pahiram ng bahay niyo sa Tagaytay. This Friday, Saturday, let's have a leadership seminar. I'm going to give you seminars on organizational skills, project management, how to write a project proposal. Tapos, let's have a strategic planning. Yung paplanuhin natin yung activities for the rest of the year. Tapos, sabihin mo sa tatay mo, pahiram na rin ang sasakyan nyo, yung van nyo. Tapos sabihin mo, bahay nyo naman yan, siya na rin magbigay ng pagkain, ha? Okay, so, and that's what we did. That's what we did. We spent overnight in their house in Tagaytay. He chose 5 of his best friends, Organization for Student Empowerment. And that club went on to organize medical missions for the janitors, security guards, maintenance men, and their families. That club organized a Christmas party for the street children in Sitio Santo Niño, right behind Southridge School. Visit to the orphanage, visit to the home for the aged, outreach left and right. And I'm glad I did not give up on Jay, even if it was very easy to give up on Jay. Because the Jay I'm talking about finished his 3 terms as governor of Quezon Province, Governor Jay Suarez, and is now congressman. Do not give up on any of your students, especially those na parang it's easy to give up on them because it's hard to deal with them, because it's hard to discipline them, because it's hard to form their character. For all you know, that guy is going to be president of a company in charge or responsible for the lives of 5,000 men and women. For all you know, that person is going to be the future president of the Philippines. I mean, what will you do if you are told that that guy inside your class one day is going to be the president of the Philippines? Paano ka magtuturo if you are told that one of your students now in grade 5 is going to be the future president, is going to be the president of the Philippines in the future? You're not going to say, "Nako, I better give more drills. I better give more assignments." Of course not. I know what you're going to do. You're going to talk about love for the poor as often as you can. You're going to talk about uprightness and honesty and not cheating as often as you can. In other words, you're going to teach for character. In other words, you're going to teach what really counts most to that class, knowing that you are preparing the future president of the Philippines. Well, it's not an exaggeration. It's possible. It's very possible. There in your classroom, this coming new school year, is the future president, is the future senator, is a future congressman of the Philippines. Teach them like you are preparing tomorrow's president. That's how we should be teaching, and that is how noble our profession is. That's how important and crucial our work is. If you don't teach that guy love for the poor, uprightness, sincerity, honesty, not taking advantage of other people, then good luck to all of us. Good luck to that kind of president who will grow up without character. So we consider our job so important because we are the ones preparing the future presidents of companies, the future congressmen and politicians, and the future shapers and shakers of society. We're lighting a fire. We are preparing a world that is brighter thanks to the hard work that we're going to put in. Okay, it's the sense of service that turns employment into a mission. When we have that sense of service, that we are not just here covering a curriculum, finishing a syllabus, covering chapters of a book. That's why I'm sure you've heard this. I've repeated it again and again in some of the past sessions, saying this: the success of a teacher does not consist in being able to finish the textbook. Ang galing kong teacher, natapos ko yung textbook. Ang galing kong teacher, na-cover namin lahat ng chapters. Okay, that's essential, that's important. But more than just that, the success of a teacher is being able to say, "Ang galing kong teacher, my students are better human beings because I taught them math, science, and English. And more than that, I showed them what is professionalism, what is hard work, what is kindness, what is respect, what is sense of responsibility. From my example, they were able to learn what it means to be not just smart, but especially good." Then that becomes a mission. That employment ceases to be merely a job. It becomes a mission, a vocation, because of that service. "I am engaged in the business of enhancing lives." This is what the teachers do. Kahit anong subject ang tinuturo nyo. And I would even dare say, kahit anong level ang tinuturoan natin, even all the way to college, even the way all the way to universities. Because the students, when they see a teacher, when they are with a teacher, they're not just expecting being able to pass a quiz or being able to pass a test. They're expecting to be able to know the most important things they need to know about the subject matter. And sometimes what is important about the subject matter is not the coverage, but it's in the attitude towards the subject, the attitude towards the whole course in general, and then the attitude towards life. That's why we are engaged in the business of enhancing lives. The future of the world is in my classroom today. And, well, I've experienced that in my 34 years inside the classroom. I've had students who went on to become presidents of companies, who went on to be teachers themselves in charge of hundreds of students. I've had students who went on to become a governor, a congressman, a mayor. I have one student now. I mean, I had one student now who is married to Alex Gonzaga. And then he was very much involved, that husband of Alex Gonzaga was very much involved in student leadership when he was in Southridge. And then looking back, you start thinking, how I wish I also taught my students how to deal with popularity, how to have the proper attitude when they become celebrities, because you realize that really some of the students you have inside the classroom today may someday be popular, celebrities, highly respected, known by many people. And if they don't know what to do with that kind of power and responsibility that they have, the power to influence many people, then we feel sayang. He or she could have been able to do much more good in society if I prepared them enough. Well, this husband of Alex Gonzaga is a city councilor of Lipa City, no? So he's in a position. I mean, he was able to use his position there, his celebrity status, to be able to make a difference in the lives of many people by serving in the community, by serving in the local government. The future of the world is in my classroom today. Think about it every time you go inside your classroom. I mean, sometimes I did that as an exercise, just to look around the class, looking at the students, and then thinking, this guy, especially because he comes from a very rich family, someday is going to be in charge or responsible for lives of 5,000 employees. This guy someday is going to take over the family business, and he will have a lot of resources in his hand. What will he do with those resources? Will he make a difference in the world? Will he uplift the lives of hundreds of people because of responsible use of the resources that he has in his life? It's good to think about that every so often when you enter your classroom. You look at the students, and then you look at all the possibilities they have in the future. And what good, the so much good that all of them combined can do, perhaps even enough to transform society, transform the world. The future of the world is in our classroom today. As a general rule, teachers teach more by what they are than by what they say. And this is the reason why the nobility of our profession is such that our example is being scrutinized by the students. Please, we have to realize this. Whatever we do inside the classroom is leaving a mark in the minds of the students. How we react to frustrating situations, even the online classrooms. How do we react when suddenly the internet lags and we cannot function properly, we cannot be heard properly? How do we react? At that moment, the students are watching. They may not be saying that they are watching us, but really, how we react to situations like that register in their mind. And all these things become like the standard for them. Ay, okay lang pala magmura. Si ma'am nga nagmura. That's the kind of message that is sent in the minds of the young people. Wow, amazing patience of ma'am or sir. Amazing self-control of not getting angry, not getting upset in spite of these kinds of situations. Whatever we do registers, whether good or bad. That's why we are teaching more by what we are than by what we say. I looked into research. Bakit nga ba nagtuturo ang mga tao? I mean, why do people get into teaching? Here are 9 reasons. And from the reasons, you will see, is there any job more noble than this? Can you find a work, employment, more worthy or more noble than that of a teacher? Here's one reason why, sabi ng research, many choose to teach. Because they want to inspire the next generation. I mean, wow. I know of another profession that has that. Inspiring the next generation, the pastors, the priests, the religious, those who dedicate themselves, their life in the service of God because they want to inspire the next generation. They want to raise up a whole new generation of men and women of faith. Fantastic. But we too are in a position of being able to do that. In fact, sometimes I tell people, mas malakas pa nga minsan ang impluensya ng teacher kesa sa pare. Kasi yung pare, ang chance ng, for the Catholics, for example, their chance of being able to hear the priest is Sundays lang. Tapos ngayon, we're even deprived of that because of the IATF rulings about bawal mga bata, bawal lang. So, but the teachers, and even during this pandemic, we continue having airtime to inspire, to motivate, to form, to raise up young people to be good men and women. So, if this is one of the top reasons why people choose to get into teaching, wow, that's a fantastic reason to inspire the next generation. Here's another reason why some people decide to teach, because they see it as a true vocation. And I mentioned earlier, really, not everyone is cut out for teaching. I remember there was a friend I invited, sige na, try mo lang, one day lang, handle the class, just to get the sense, the feeling. You know, after a 50-minute period, pagbalik namin sa faculty room, sabi niya, he was so exhausted. And he said, this is not for me. Kung one class lang, parang pagod na ako, how can I last 200 class days? And not just one class like that a day. Sometimes a teacher can have 3, 4, or even 5 in a day. How can you last like that? That's why if you have lasted for so long in the teaching profession, I congratulate yourself for having that vocation, for having a mission. So, it's a true vocation. Here's another reason, sabi ng research, why some teachers enter the profession, why some people enter the profession. They're passionate about their subject. They study math, they fall in love with math, they take up math in college, and they want to teach it. That's passion. Okay, very nice. Some others, they study science, they fall in love with science, they, even if they practice medicine in the hospital, they want to get back to the classroom and train the next generation of doctors. Passion for the subject, that's one reason. But by itself, wow, that's a very noble thing. I mean, to fall in love with something and to have passion for something is by itself a great thing. Here's number 4. Why do some people get into the teaching profession? Sabi ng research, ito daw, a clear career path. Now, I put this next to on the right side of the slide because it's arguable. I mean, some of us can say, doubtful, arguable. Pwedeng i-debate. Yeah, debatable. Kasi nga naman, anong clear path for a teacher? Teacher, tapos kailangan maging subject coordinator, tapos dapat maging vice principal, tapos principal. Is that a clear career path? Hindi ba pwedeng, I am a teacher and I will die a teacher. I don't want administrative work. I just went year after year after year, inspiring students, forming students, molding the minds of students, raising them up to be good men and women of character by teaching math. Yeah, and I've seen teachers like that teaching grade 2 for 50 years. I mean, I'm not exaggerating. I've seen teachers like that who do not look at being an officer as part of their career path because they are happy enough that year after year, at the end of each year, they're able to say, there goes my new set of children ready for the higher grade, ready for more in life, ready for bigger challenges that await them. Fantastic. And that should be an acceptable thing for us, that someone can decide, I just want to be a master teacher of my subject. I don't want administrative posts. Okay, so it can be because of a clear career path in the teaching profession that makes some people, ito, I will choose this. Here's the other one, salary benefits. Especially because, well, if you're teaching, for example, in the United States, summer break is real summer break. And while many other professions, they don't get that. They are just entitled to a certain number of leaves. Pero tayong teachers, aba, meron pa tayong mandatory leave, summer break leave. Of course, because of this pandemic, the public school teachers are kawawa naman, ano, nawalan ng, ano, ng break. I mean, with all these extensions of the school year and things like that. Pero, we look at, oo nga, we still have blessings to count in the teaching profession. May mga salary benefits pa rin, kahit paano. I mean, we're not forever contractual, for example. So, this is one reason why some teachers, according to research, enter the profession, why some people enter the teaching profession. Here's another one, international opportunities. And the pandemic has shown us, ay, oo nga, now I can actually be teaching someone in the other countries. With this online setup now, I can actually be teaching based in Cebu while my students are in Manila or in Tuguegarao. And it's possible. And then we do have really international opportunities. Many countries especially are looking for teachers who are proficient in English to be able to teach English. Many schools. In fact, online, there are many opportunities for teaching English. No? But with a lot of hard work and then with a lot of juggling of office hours. I mean, because if these students are from other countries, then they follow a different timeline, etc. But I know some teachers who got into the profession because they were looking at being able to end up being hired in the United States, in Australia, in Canada, and in Korea, that is in dire need of good English teachers, in Japan, the same, in Dubai, the same. In Dubai, we have a big Filipino community there. I understand we even have schools there run by Filipinos and for Filipinos. International opportunities. Here's another reason why some people enter the profession, because there is a certain job security. I mean, in the first place, you have to finish the school year. And then we can get permanent. And then we can get more benefits as we stay longer in the job. That's a seventh reason why some people enter the profession. But we will still end up with the nobility of the teaching profession. One reason why some people enter the profession is because it's a great way to be of service to families. And really, teachers sometimes are in loco parentis, in the place of the parents. Those of you who have been teaching for a long time, you know that. Sometimes you will have students who find it easier to open up to you than to their mom, than to their dad. Sometimes you get to know more about the student especially in the older ones, the high school students, you get to know more about the students than the parents know about their children. We are in the service of families. That's why the teaching profession, our clients are not just the students. Many times our client is the entire family, especially if you're in a school like PAREF schools, Parents for Education Foundation, where they get the parents to collaborate directly. There you can really say our clients go beyond the classroom. Our clients are also the parents. We want to form them too. Well, that's a hallmark of a great school. When your school reaches out to parents and get them to collaborate with you in raising the young people to become good people, not just smart, but especially good. Some enter the profession because by being a teacher, you become a lifelong learner. Sabi nila, the best way to learn is to teach. O nga naman, ano? You understand better the subject matter when you will have to teach it. Then you will have to learn. Bakit nahihirapan sila dito? Bakit nahihirapang intindihin ito? And then you will have to be able to understand the complexity of the whole problem for you to be able to teach it so that the students will really understand it. And then by design, we will teach it according to how they're going to learn it. That's becoming a lifelong learner. I mean, nowadays you hear a lot about be a lifelong learner. Well, this is the teaching profession. Not only are we a lifelong learner, we become lifelong teachers. Always eager to be able to impart knowledge. So then, all those 9 that I mentioned, and 6 or 7 of them, have reference to the nobility of the teaching profession, or point to the fact that our job is so noble. It requires sacrifice. It requires heart. It requires a real desire to serve, to make a difference, to raise people like this, kids like this, who unang tingin parang notorious, naughty, but never mind. Iniisip natin, I'm going to discipline this guy. I'm going to raise up this guy to be a better human being. That's why we are always proud to say our profession is like this, a flame that lights the path of a child. We are like the flame bringer to the world that is getting darker and darker with all the bad news we hear about, the criminalities that we see in TV Patrol and 24 Horas, and then the poverty that many people are thrown into because of the situation, because of joblessness, because of the pandemic, because of the lockdown and the quarantine. We will have to come to the conclusion that I am not just fulfilling a job, an employment. This is a vocation. This is a mission. And then it's a profession. I am a professional teacher. That's why the title of this series is The Professional Teacher. If we see our job as that, so noble, so important, a vocation, a mission, I better do it well. I better do it professionally. One looks back with appreciation to the brilliant teachers, but with gratitude to those who touched our human feelings. Time to let you tell you another story. I had a very fantastic Latin teacher in high school. His name was Severino Estrera. Okay, he was a great Latin teacher, very good teacher. And then one day I received a text message, "Man, please include in your prayers Mr. Estrera, who's been in and out of the hospital because of health problems, and he is bankrupt." Ganun yung message na na-receive ko. So, I posted in my Facebook Sabi ko, because during that time, I was in touch with the hundreds of graduates of Southridge School. I was once upon a time alumni coordinator. And so I'm friends with many, many graduates, including those that were not my batchmates. I posted, "Hey guys, please include in your prayers Mr. Estrada, who's been in and out of the hospital and is in dire need of help." That's what I posted. Immediately, so many people started messaging from all over the world, because our graduates in Southridge are all over the world, scattered all over the world. Somebody said, "Hey man, thanks very much for the info. Please tell Mr. Estrada that we will pray for him. We're offering our prayers to him." Somebody said, "Thanks for the info, man. Do you have his number? I want to give him a call." Somebody said, "Thanks for the info, man. Do you have his home address? I want to organize a batch reunion in his house." So many fantastic, beautiful messages from all over. Students who became, who was in his class many years ago. But the best message came from Chestnut Heredia, Dr. Chestnut Heredia, an ophthalmologist, who said, "Thanks very much, man. I will take care of everything." And because, you know, he is an ophthalmologist and his wife owns a hospital. And so that was his message. "Thanks very much for the info, man. I will take care of everything." And in fact, that's what he did. Next Saturday, he picked him up from the house, brought him to the hospital, did the operation on cataract, one eye, and then gave him medicines, brought him back home. And then the following week, picked him up again, brought him to the hospital, performed the operation on the other eye, gave him all the medicines he needed, and gave him all the things he needed for to get better. And I think we did that because we remembered him as somebody who took care of us, who was a very good teacher, a very good professional, who did not yell, scream, use foul language, bad words. No, he was highly respected. And that's what it means to be a teacher, that someday the students that pass through our classes are just too eager to be able to return the favor. They just want to be able to give back in whatever way they can someday. You know, as all, I always tell people, the moral lesson of the story is, marry someone who owns a hospital so that you don't have to worry. No, just kidding. I mean, the moral lesson there is, really, we have to teach, taking care of our students, because someday they will take care of us. And when I say that, I don't say it with a sense of selfishness or greed, or I will do this so that I can get help from them later on. No, it's just the most natural thing, really, that when we give ourselves generously to the students now, someday they too will look forward to being able to give back, to be able to help in whatever way they can. After all, that's the reality of life. That's the reality of life. Someday we may actually be needing their help. I mean, in my 34 years inside the classroom, I've stayed a teacher while most of my students, if not all, went on to become millionaires, billionaires, very rich, filthy rich. But we continue being inside the classroom, receiving perhaps better salary, but still nothing compared to how much all these students that have passed through our classes are making now in out there in their own chosen profession. So, with gratitude to those who touched our human feelings, Carl Jung says, and the teachers are in a position to touch human feelings of the students. A man knows when he has found his vocation when he stops thinking about how to live and begins to live. And this is what a teacher is. We live day after day with a realization that we're able to make a difference. That the young people who are inside their classroom now will go on to be successful. Some highly successful in whatever profession they choose. That is the joy of a teacher, of knowing that someday, itong mga estudyanteng hinahawakan ko, ito yung pasaway, ito yung maingay, they are going to be influential, powerful, maybe very rich, maybe occupying very important positions, but they were once upon a time inside our classroom. I'm sure all of you teachers like me who have been inside the classroom for more than 20 years can rattle off think about the students that who were there inside your classroom 20 years ago and are now they appear in TV Patrol being interviewed, experts in their field, authorities in their chosen profession. There are very few real teachers. Teaching is not a job, it's a vocation. To be a great one, many qualities must be combined. Love of truth, knowledge, reverence, loving concern for one's students, clarity, and patience. That's from philosopher Alice von Hildebrand. Very beautiful. And this should make us realize even more the nobility of our teaching profession and how important our job is. Okay, what exactly is the mission to teach? Alfred North Whitehead says, is it to help the child become the man of culture and of expertise? Bertrand Russell, is it to provide opportunities for the child's growth and to remove hampering influences? To teach is to influence every child entrusted in your care to become better and happier because life becomes more meaningful. In the end, sometimes we can say, life of the students become meaningful because we help them find the meaning in their life. To teach is to help a child become more human. I mean, let's think about it because it's true. We find meaning in our life thanks to one teacher or another who inspired us, who opened our eyes. As I mentioned at the start, I think some of us decided to become a teacher precisely because of that one teacher or another who inspired us, who moved us, who made us realize, wow, I want to be that kind, like mom, like sir. If you haven't read Tuesdays with Maury, I'd like you to do it as a summer assignment. Tuesdays with Maury by, what's his name? Yeah. One of the lines there that is so memorable, he said he decided to become a teacher because he decided to get a job that does not hurt anyone. Fantastic. I decided to get a job that does not hurt anyone, that does not take advantage of anyone. And that is the teaching profession where the teacher gives himself, gives of himself to the students. That's why sometimes we are told we are like a candle, diba? I'm sure there, Mitch Album. Thank you very much, ma'am. Capus, for that, the author of Tuesdays with Maury. But if you want to watch the movie version, which personally for me is more powerful also, but the most powerful one is the stage play that I got to watch two actors for 2 hours just talking on stage. That's even more powerful. If you want a copy of the movie, send me an email, catalystpds@gmail.com. Tell me, I want the movie. Tuesdays with Maury, Mitch Album, produced by Oprah Winfrey. I will pass it on to you. It's available in my Google Drive precisely for teachers because that movie, I mean, Maury is a teacher. No? He died giving the Tuesday lessons to Mitch It's a sort of autobiographical, actually. It's based on the real life of Mitch and his teacher, his professor, Maury. So, there. I want a job that does not take advantage of anyone. I chose a job that makes the lives of other people. And he chose the teaching profession. A teacher is a special friend whose love and kindness never ends. But as I always tell, especially young teachers, you're not meant to be merely friends with your students, okay? You're meant to be role models of your students. Someone they will look up to. Someone they will say, paglaki ko gusto ko kagaya nun, maging kagaya ni Sel, maging kagaya ni Ma'am. That is, be friendly, be very, very friendly, but you are not merely going to be friends. Because I've seen this happen to some young teachers na parabang trying to be liked, trying too hard to be popular, yan, by being a friend, barkada to the students. I've seen that tragically end in many occasions of teachers who try so hard to be popular, to be liked, and to be merely a friend. You're not merely a friend. You are a role model. Teaching is a profession that teaches all the other professions. And it's true, really. That's why we're called basic education in the grades 1 to 12. It's because these students inside your classroom will go on to be doctors, to be lawyers, to be accountants, to be whatever it is that we want them to be. The only limitation is their dream, their bigness of heart. But they can be whatever they want to be, even the president of the country. And that's what we do in the basic education. We prepare them for whatever profession they're going to end up in. Teachers don't impact for a year, but for a lifetime. And this has to be very clear in our mind. Such, again, is the nobility of our profession, that we are capable of leaving a mark that can be for lifetime, for the rest of the life of the students. But unfortunately, this can be for the good or for the bad, because it has happened also. I mentioned earlier, you have some students who can grow up to be full of resentments, even full of anger and frustration and dislike for authority because of bad experience with one terror teacher or another. We do not just impact them for a year, but for a lifetime. Example isn't another way to teach. It's the only way to teach. And that's why we always talk about, to the powerful example of our life, we will be able to form their character and mold their minds. I remember, and I have some friends here from Philippine Science main campus, and I was invited to give a tribute to three teachers, three educators who are going to retire, two after 35, 36 years, one after 25 years. And even in their retirement, this is the nobility of our profession. Even in their retirement, after working as teachers for 35, 36 years, they continue teaching all of us. All these things they teach us, the meaning of dedication. 36 years inside the classroom. Can you beat that? Loyalty, commitment. I mean, if that is not commitment, I don't know what is. Professionalism, perseverance, resilience, grit, honor, toughness. And so this also serves as an invitation to all of you, dear teachers, stay on in the teaching profession. It's so noble. It's so important. It's so crucial. We need people who are going to be there for the rest of their life. And then most importantly, that's love. I mean, I don't think you can last a day if you don't love enough. A person who doesn't know how to love, yung laging galit, galit sa buong mundo, galit sa lahat ng tao, galit sa bansa, galit sa politika, galit sa nakikita sa television, lahat galit. A person like that, and then does not see the need to love the students, the need to love the families entrusted to his care through the classes that he is going to handle. A person who is incapable of loving will not last in the teaching profession. And the reason why many of us have been here for 30 years, 20 years, is because we love enough to see beyond the sometimes disrespectful action of one student or another, the lazy attitude shown by one student or another. We see beyond that and we think that this guy is not hopeless. Kaya pa yan. Kaya pa to. Hindi ito hopeless case na I will give up on him. That is love. Very much like parents who, when they see the defects of their children, they're ready to cover up for their defects because of love. I mean, they think, no, siguro bad mood lang ang anak ko, kaya siya napasigaw sa akin. And then they're ready to forgive because that is what family is. When you, a family is a place where there is forgiving. I mean, the forgiveness that is rooted in love. So a teacher can last for years, for decades, even up to the end of our life. And we're teaching everyone all these meanings. Okay, well, I will not go into the four stages of teaching. That is very much a part of, that is more a part of the, how do you call this? The Harry Wong's stages of teaching. I will be ending in a while, but I'd like to leave you with just some more inspiring words to make us see more than just the nobility of our profession, how important our profession is. And that's why we take care of it. We try to be the best teachers we can possibly be for the sake of our students. Many times when I give presentation, I usually would start with the crisis in society, the crisis in character, the crisis of teen pregnancy, digital addiction, self-centeredness, the death of empathy, etc. In order to drive home the point that, you see, that's why we need to teach character. That's why we need to be the best teachers we can possibly be, because the students now more than ever need us. They need the adults, especially we teachers, who are always the ones there at the forefront of dealings with them. And that is how we touch lives forever. We are like artists. A little child is like a worthless stone on the road. Teachers sculpt him. We're like master sculptors, master painters, master artists. That's why sometimes we say teaching is a science and an art, because every student is like a worthless stone. We make him, we shape him, we polish him and shine him, and every single one of them turns out to be a gem sooner or later. Some sooner, some later, but nevertheless, all of them turn out to be gems later on. Such is the nobility of the teaching profession. Effective teachers impact lives. Teachers who are proficient and effective are more capable of impacting the lives of students than teachers who are not proficient and effective. So, because of the nobility of our profession, it's an invitation. The session today is really nothing else but an invitation. Sir, ma'am, let's be the best teachers we can possibly be. Kasi kailangan tayo ng mga kabataan. Kasi napakahalaga ng trabaho natin. Kasi napaka-noble ng ating chosen profession. It's not just like any other job. We, you and I, were hired to impact lives. You were hired not so much to teach third grade or history or physics or physical education, but we were hired to influence lives. And it's a good thought to always foster Especially pag napagod na kayo. Kasi totoo yun, nakakapagod maging teacher. Nakakapagod maging mabuting teacher. Dati, pag June ang start ng school year, in my 34 years, as in my 25 years or so as administrator, I've seen this already. Pag June ang start ng school year, by August, nag-uumpisa na ma-burn out ang ibang teachers. Nag-uumpisa na silang mapagod. Administrators who are here, please watch out. 2 months into the school year, usually, dyan nag-uumpisa yung pagod, exhaustion, exasperation even. Ang kailangan lang ng teachers is a bit more inspiration at that point. A bit of rest. A good rest, like minsan sasabihin mo, okay, faculty, this coming Friday, instead of faculty meeting, we will watch a very inspiring teacher movie. Yung mga tipong The Ron Clark Story, highly inspiring. O kaya, yung one-hour presentation dun sa Harry Wong video on You Changed My Life, a very powerful presentation of a man who will teach you sign language by giving that talk on You Changed My Life, where he gives tribute to his teacher. Minsan, yun lang ang kailangan ng teachers. And that is enough to make them get back to their peak again. No more exhaustion, no more burnout, no more exasperation and tiredness. Because the work that we have hired them for is supposed to influence lives. It's like a candle that is burning to give off light for the sake of the young people, for the sake of the students. Ay, talagang nakakapagod yun. It's tiring to be inspiring. Believe me. It is. Teaching is not just hard work, it's heart work. And this is the reason why it can be very tiring. And that's why we say, long live the teachers. Because it's tiring because we are not in a private practice. We are in the helping and caring profession, a service profession to help people enhance the quality of their lives. Ay, talagang nakakapagod yan. And minsan, pati sa pagtulog natin, pagising pa lang, naiisip na natin minsan yung mga estudyante, ano? Especially yung mga sometimes difficult students to handle. It becomes a 24-hour job. Especially pagkabiglang one day, you're asked by the principal to head the discipline committee to investigate a case. And wow, that can be very, very tiring. But, well, okay, it's tiring. It's not very easy. Pero 100 years from now, it will not matter what kind of car I drove, what kind of house I lived in, how much I had in the bank account, or what my clothes looked like. But the world will be a better place because I was important in the life of a child. And that is a teaching profession. We make a difference. So, teachers, courage. It's not going to be very easy. There will be bumps, humps, difficulties along the way. Pero this is what we need now. The courage to continue on in spite of the difficulties because the young people need us.